Testament. Let's take a moment to pray, and then we'll look at a couple of verses here in chapter 9 of Isaiah. Father, we pray as we turn to your word this morning that this would be a moment of discovery, that we would find the gift of Christ and all that he has come to accomplish in your word, as we see here, that there is so much for us to gain and to enjoy. And I pray, Father, that you would open the eyes of our hearts to truth, that as your word goes forth, that it would bring a nourishment and encouragement, and that our eyes would be open, the eyes of our hearts, that is, to all that you have for us and all that you want for us as followers of you. And we ask these things in Jesus' name. Amen. Now, you may have heard this phrase, and it's kind of been around for quite a few years, the gift that keeps on giving. And that phrase actually has its roots in Christmas advertising. And years back, almost 100 years ago, they started to coin this phrase because people, probably around the turn of, around the early 1900s, the idea of giving gifts became more and more prevalent around Christmas time. And as many of you know, when you get a gift, sometimes what happens after about 3 days, it kind of loses its luster. You know, have you ever noticed that, you know, that toy that kid has, or maybe something you've received even or given, you know, you're excited about it for a little while, but then after a bit, it just sort of fades away. And I mean, I was totally fired up about getting a set of trains when I was a kid, and I loved my trains and I played with my trains, but I'm still not terribly excited about them. I mean, I could probably sell them on eBay and make a small fortune, but you know, those old things, you know, you find that these things sort of fade. And marketers back around 1920 or so wanted to generate this idea of a gift that keeps on giving. So they came up with this slogan, and one of the first gifts that they decided would keep on giving was this. It is it's a stove. And that's a 1920s electric stove, and they decided this would be the perfect gift that would just keep on giving. And so the first gift that had, or one of the early gifts that had this catchphrase associated with it, was a stove. Many of you may have seen one of these. That's a radio, and radios were very popular during the 20s, 30s, 40s, even into the 50s before television became prominent. My grandfather had one very similar to this, and he would just, every Sunday afternoon after lunch, he would go in and he would listen to the ball game. And this was that gift that you could just keep on giving. Here's one that a little retro that some of you may have actually had. The old television sets. I mean, you needed like 25 people to carry these suckers into your house, and they had a stereo built in with the you know, the surround sound and all this other, and the tubes on those things they weighed a ton. And so that was another gift. RCA called the television set the gift that would keep on giving. Magazine subscriptions became titled as gifts that would keep on giving. Nikon cameras in the 70s were considered the gift that would keep on giving. And you hear this phrase cropping up from time to time. But when we think about Messiah, and we think about what Jesus came to do, there is a gift here that continues to give. And it actually gets better over time. As we explore the passage here in Isaiah 9, 4 through 5, we've been looking at what did Jesus come to accomplish. And the first introduction here to the psalm was that this notion of light, that darkness would be dispelled and light would come and we'd have guidance and we'd have comfort. We discussed last week the fact that joy would accompany Messiah, and that, you know, in the midst of all this doom and gloom, which is really what we find Isaiah 9 nestled in, is this Assyrian invasion and, you know, all these problems with oppression from people from other countries, that there would be joy for God's people. And now we have here this new gift that's going to keep on giving that we'll explore in Isaiah 9, verses 4 and 5. The Word of God tells us this. For you shall break the yoke of their burden and the staff on their shoulders, the rod of their oppressor, as at the battle of Midian. For every boot of the booted warrior in the battle tumult and cloak rolled in blood will be for burning fuel for the fire. And we'll stop right there. What we have here in this passage is really an intervention, an elimination, and finally some application. The intervention here is that Messiah, now we shift gears from joy, now Messiah would be a warrior, and that there would be this tremendous victory. And Isaiah points his readers back to Gideon. the battle with Midian, the defeat of the Midianites who were highly oppressive. And we see in the book of Judges, we actually studied this back quite a while back in our Sunday school class as we were looking at how the Midianites had invaded Israel and they had oppressed the people. They were taking taxes, they were taking their livestock, they were taking their crops. I mean, we find Gideon, the introduction to Gideon is he's threshing wheat in the wine press because he's afraid. And we find here that there is this sense of loss, there's this sense of heaviness, there's depression, and people are just scratching out a living, barely keeping their nose above water as they're dealing with this foreign invasion. And Messiah, we see here, and this is highly symbolic, is going to come in and he's going to crush this oppressor. Messiah would completely destroy this yoke, this burden that they would be carrying upon their backs. And the rod, literally, here that they're speaking about in Isaiah, would be that of like a taskmaster, someone who would be lording over them and dictating how they live their lives, someone who would be pulling in the reins and producing this heavy sense of oppression and cruelty. And we see this beautifully illustrated with the Egyptians. And many of you are familiar with the story of Moses and how Pharaoh had the taskmasters who oppressed the Israelites as they were making the bricks in Egypt right before the Exodus story. And Midian did this. They exacted taxes, and the Assyrians were doing this. And this is more specifically as to what Isaiah was speaking about, the invasion from this army from the north. And what we have here is a picture. A very vivid picture, an image that everyone in Israel clearly understood. And that was you had this foreign invader oppressing people, robbing them of their freedom, and putting them under this yoke, this heaviness of slavery. And one of the things that this picture points us to is what sin does in our lives. That when we succumb to sin, and all of us are in the same boat together this morning, because all of us continue to make mistakes. All of us continue to sin. There is a sense of heaviness. There's a sense of oppression. There's a sense of bondage that comes from being enslaved to sin. Listen to what Ecclesiastes tells us. Ecclesiastes 8:8 paints us this picture. As no one is discharged in time of war, so wickedness will not release those who practice it. All of us understand this sting. Every one of us in this room has struggled with something. It could be fear. It could be selfishness. It could be lust. It could be pride. It could be anxiety. It could be bitterness. It could be your past. There's a whole host of things. Just like these warriors in ancient times who would oppress other nations, we too understand firsthand what it means to feel oppressed by the weight of sin. And today, people bear a tremendous burden, and that burden is something that only Jesus can lift. We find here that Messiah, not the people of Israel, not a foreign army, no one else but God, Messiah would be the one who would deliver his people Israel. And we see that in our first point, the first part of what Isaiah is painting for us here in this beautiful passage, is that Messiah would come to relieve us and lift that heavy burden that many of us have been carrying, and some of you carried it right through the door this morning when you came to church. Knew a woman years back. She was thinking about moving back to her hometown and live with her folks. She had finished up school and had worked for a little while, and she wanted to come home, and she decided she wasn't going to go back to her hometown because she says, quote, my past wouldn't let me go. Knew of a fella, he had retired, and I was talking to him, this is quite a few years back, and he said to me, I've got some struggles ahead this winter. I've got to pay for my medicine, and I've got to pay for my heating oil. And you know, when I was younger, I used to live paycheck to paycheck, and I spent everything I had, and I was very foolish with what I earned. And now I've got to buy these two things, and I can only afford one. That's that heaviness, that oppression that many of us understand all too well. And one of the good parts about this passage is that Messiah has come. And part of this gift that keeps on giving is the freedom that Jesus is extending to you and to me this morning. the elimination here we have in the second part. And this is kind of a strange illustration. He mentions the warrior's boot and the garment rolled in blood here. And these are accoutrements here. These are, you know, when people went out into battle, you know, they had, they wore boots if they could afford them. And a lot of armies actually would fight barefooted, which really put them at a disadvantage. But believe it or not, this was one of the key weapons in an assault or in the military was to have good footwear. And they found that the armies that had the good sandals, the Romans mastered creating footwear, believe it or not, so that their soldiers would not have blisters and bruises and things on their feet. Because if you can't walk, you can't fight. I mean, that's end of story. And so these accoutrements here are going to be destroyed in a fire. And they're going to just be eliminated altogether. And what is this telling us here? Why does he mention these things? It's because the victory of Messiah will be complete. It'll be over. It'll be total. You won't have to go back and find out those old warrior boots and get your shield out. I had a cousin of mine, he fought in Vietnam, and he would go out on these two-week patrols, search and destroy missions. And they wouldn't shower, they wouldn't do anything. You know, they were just out there in the bush hunting down the Viet Cong, and when they came back to their base camp, they would burn their clothes. They smelled so terrible. They would never use them again because it was just so rank. And what we have here is that there's this elimination altogether of this need for people to be afraid of fighting this war ever again. Listen to what Micah tells us. The book of Micah explains, "And he will judge between many peoples and render decisions for mighty distant nations. Then they will hammer their swords into plowshares and their spears into pruning hooks. Nation will not lift up sword against nation, and never again will they train for war." And what we find as Micah is piggybacking on what Isaiah is saying here is that the victory of Messiah will be complete and it will be permanent. And on the cross, Jesus Christ, when he died and he rose, his victory for you and for me is complete. It is permanent. It is something that he is extending to us. And it is a wonderful illustration here, what we see in this passage, of what Jesus is going to accomplish when he comes to planet Earth. And his victory will be threefold. And we touched upon this last week for just a moment. He will conquer Satan. He will conquer sin. And he will conquer death. He will conquer Satan, who is the source of temptation, who is the one that chides us and goads us and entices us to sin. And we find here in John's gospel that on the cross, Jesus defeats Satan. John 12:31 says, "Now judgment is upon this world. Now the ruler of this world will be cast out." And part of the victory that our Messiah has accomplished for us is that the tempter, the one who has been pulling the strings, who's been lying to us, who has been trying to dictate how we live our lives, will now be defeated, number one. Number two, the whole notion of sin, which is when we succumb to those temptations, when we give in to them. And everyone understands in this room exactly what that means. Christ will destroy. Listen to what we find here in the book of Colossians. Colossians chapter 2, verses 13 through 15. "When you were dead in your transgressions and the uncircumcision of your flesh, he made you alive together with him, having forgiven us all our transgressions, having canceled out the certificate of debt consisting of decrees against us, which was hostile to us, and he has taken it away of the way, having nailed it to the cross. When he had disarmed the rulers and the authorities, he made public display of them, having triumphed them over them through him." And what we find here is that Christ's victory over Satan also now extends to sin. And we can now find forgiveness and freedom in Christ because of what he has done on the cross. And ultimately, the bondage that comes with that, and ultimately what we would see as death. The victory over death is what we also find in Jesus' three-part victory here. We see in Romans 6:23, "For the wages of sin is death, but the free gift of God is what? Eternal life in Christ Jesus our Lord." Satan, sin, and death. And when we talk about death, it's not just physical death. It's the separation that occurs. Because let's face it, when we sin, what happens? We begin to die almost immediately. Our relationship with God is now stymied. Our relationship with other people is hindered. Our relationship even within ourselves begins to fall apart. And there's a battle that wages even within us. And many of us have found that we disdain our own self because of the things that we've done and the things that we've said and the things that we think. And there is this sense of separation, this tearing apart that occurs. And that's the death that many of us are struggling with, the oppression of sin that we are facing each and every day as we wrestle with our thoughts, as we wrestle with our words, as we wrestle with our deeds. So what do we do here? Recognize the work of Messiah. Recognize what he has come to accomplish. I had an uncle years back who loved the game of golf. And when he was like 5 or 6 years old, his father took him out on the golf course for the first time. And he would go out there and he would be whacking balls around. And he just played all through his entire life. He just enjoyed golfing. Well, he and my aunt, they never had any children, and they retired very, very young because they had the means to do so. They moved down to a retirement community along the shore, and for their first Christmas after my uncle had retired from his job, my aunt had purchased him a lifetime membership to the local country club. And she felt this was going to be the gift that would keep on giving. Paid in full, and my uncle was absolutely thrilled. He was on the green 3 times a week, you know, whacking those balls around, and he retired, I think, around 55, 56 years old. He lived to 96. He played golf until he was 94 years old, and that gift just kept on giving over and over and over again because he was able to go out there and enjoy the time on the green and a sport that he absolutely adored. And the beauty of that whole story and the parallel to it is quite simple. His lifetime membership was paid in full. So he had continual access to the carts, to the greens, to the clubhouse, to all of the different activities that happened at that country club, because my aunt paid the price in full. When Jesus came, his mission didn't end at a cradle, but on a cross. And when he died, as he was dying, as he's hanging there, breathing his final breaths, he cries out, what? It is finished. Literally in Greek, that means paid in full. So that we could have access to the Father forever. Through his blood, through his sacrifice, through his broken body, we now have this beautiful gift that he is presenting to us called eternal life. So what do we do with all this? Where's the application come in? There's really two things. The work of Messiah really revolves around forgiveness and freedom. Forgiveness comes when we place our faith in Christ. We can't add to it. We can't take from it. His work was complete. It was perfect. It was satisfactory. It appeased the Father. And because of what Jesus does on the cross, for everyone who believes in him, we can have forgiveness and reconciliation with the Holy God. Forgiveness is the first area of action. And if you haven't received Christ as Savior, then I implore you, I encourage you to place your faith in him, because he has extended grace and mercy to all of humanity because he loves us. He cares for us. And that's why he came to die and rise 3 days later. So the gift of forgiveness is where it begins. But now we have this notion of freedom that comes in, the gift that will continue to give throughout the course of the year. And I liken it to this. Imagine yourself in prison. You're shackled. You're behind bars. And now suddenly the king offers you emancipation, a pardon, because you've placed your faith in his son. And what happens at that moment, when a person trusts Christ for their salvation, when we take that step and receive Jesus as our Savior, what ends up occurring is that the door of the prison is unlocked. The shackles are loosed. We have now the opportunity to walk in freedom. But we must take that step out. Forgiveness is free. But the freedom requires us to obey. I could be positionally right with God. I could receive Christ as my Savior. And I could have the opportunity to walk in freedom. But if I opt to stay in that cell, and if I choose to continue a life of sin, I will stay in that bondage. And this is the wrestling match that every one of us in this room goes through, even as believers. I want to point you back here to the passage in John's Gospel. John 8:31. Listen to what Jesus is saying. This is what we read earlier. So Jesus was saying to the Jews who had what? Believed in him. These are believers. The word here, pisteo in Greek, means they have placed their faith in Christ. They understand he is Messiah. They understand that the work he's going to accomplish is going to rescue them. They have come to that point. They are not ignoring the truth of the gospel and what they know of it. What does Jesus say to people who have placed their faith in Christ? To the Jews who had believed him, if you continue in my word, then you are truly my disciples. And then what did he say after that? And then you will what? Know the truth. And the truth will do what? What is that? Set you free. This is where we find forgiveness comes through faith. The freedom comes as we understand the truth and walk in the truth. And this is why he will go on to say later on in John 8:36, so if the Son makes you free, you will be free indeed. We need God's help. We need God's word. We need God's empowerment. But that freedom we can discover. And this is the gift that keeps on giving day after day. It's to be able to walk in freedom. And this is something that many of us have struggled with. We feel oppressed. We feel bound. We feel stuck in our sins. We feel stuck in our past. We feel stuck with guilt and shame. We are walking in this. And that truth, that we could find freedom in Christ, that we could find deliverance in Christ, that we could be released of this cell, this prison that many of us have been walking in, that's the gift that Messiah wants us to enjoy each day as we find greater and greater levels of freedom in Christ, as we submit to his truth and obey him and follow after him. Let me give you a picture of what this looks like and we'll wrap it up. I knew a young guy years back whose father was highly abusive. Dad was an alcoholic who would come home, smack mom around, smack the kids around. And this young boy's prayer as a child was that he would grow up and become big enough and strong enough to take down his own father. That's what he would pray every night. He was in junior high, probably around eighth grade or so, late junior high. His father comes home one night, tanked, swearing, just being belligerent, walks in the house, smacks his mom right at the kitchen table. He looks the other way, the father does, and this young guy, he's gotten a little bit bigger. He grabs, you know those old Heinz ketchup bottles that were made out of glass? They weighed about 15 pounds, all right? You remember those things. He picks up one of them ketchup bottles, and he smashes his father across the face with a ketchup bottle, gouges him up, knocks him out. Cops come in, ambulance is there, the whole nine yards. That was the last time he ever saw his father. They carted him off. The dad had a rap sheet and all sorts of problems. He never saw his dad again. But as he grew up, this young man, the bitterness, the anger continued to fester. And the man he hated, he became as a husband. And in his early 20s, he gets married, and he starts shooting off his life. He's just as belligerent. He's just as nasty. And his wife separates for a little while. She works for some woman who leads her to Christ, shares the gospel with her, encourages her to try to bring reconciliation to the home. And this woman comes back to her husband and insists he's got to start going to church. He's got to make some changes. And he hates himself. This guy is, there's that sense of separation. There's this burden. He's been carrying around this weight ever since he's a little kid. And he finally, after a couple of months, agrees he's going to go to church. He sits down in church. He hears the gospel for the first time. And he says, I need this forgiveness. I need to find Christ. I've got to change. And he doesn't know how. And he makes that decision to receive Christ as his Savior. Months go by, but he's still bound. He's found the forgiveness, but he's still bound by his past and by the pain and by all that anger that's been building up and by the fear that has been driving him, that need to control and the manipulation and the need to just see everything go right and everything just fall in place the way he wants it. And as he's reading his Bible and he gets involved with groups of men, he discovers slowly how to surrender his past to Christ, how to see himself not through the lens of how his father painted him as a loser, but through the lens of Scripture that paints him as a saint, as a child of God, as someone who has value and purpose, someone who is cherished by the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. And as he begins to see this truth, the shackles begin to fall off, and he begins to realize his identity in Christ, the love of Christ, his value in Christ, and that he does not need to control his world. He does not need to vent. He could forgive his father. He could forgive himself. He could forgive his pet. He could just let go of all this. And he starts to walk slowly in freedom. This fellow ends up sadly getting sick not too long after. And he passes away. And at his funeral, his wife had you've seen the cards that you get from the funeral homes. And she had his favorite verse on the front, and on the back it had the vital information about his birth and his death date and his name. And she asked the funeral home director to print something underneath his name on the card. She really wanted everybody to see three words, just three simple words, on that card, so that everyone who walked in and as their final testimony to understand who her husband was and is, she had these three words printed: forgiven and free. And that summed this man's life as he walked with Christ. The gift that keeps on giving, we find forgiveness through faith in Christ, and we find freedom through obedience to Christ. And that is the gift that Messiah wants every one of us in this room to enjoy: forgiveness and freedom. Let's take a moment to pray. Father, we come before you, and as we consider these powerful truths in your word, I pray that they would just sink deep into our hearts. I pray, Father, that we would want to trust you. We'd also want to obey you, because your word tells us who the Son sets free will be free indeed. And I pray, Father, that this morning, as we are wrestling, as we are struggling, as we are hobbling under the yoke of our own oppression and bondage, the things that we have said and done, I pray, Father, that we would let these things go. That we would take a few quiet moments, perhaps today, perhaps during the course of this week, to leave the heaviness at the foot of the cross and have a change of heart, a change of mind, change of actions. Lord, we are struggling people, and we need you every step of the way. And I pray, Father, that we would just cast our cares and our burdens, our mistakes and our past upon you, and leave this room this morning a little more free, and that we'd walk in that freedom the rest of our lives. For it's in Jesus' name we pray.